Thanks very much, Chair, and thanks to Deputy O'Callaghan and Deputy Gould. And apologies to our guest. I was over in the Dáil, so if I'm repeating questions that were asked earlier, my apologies in advance. Could I ask, given that we are, I think you would accept, or maybe it's a question as well, that we are behind the curve on designating marine protected areas compared to many, many other countries in Europe, and we're playing catch up. How do you envisage us dealing with the legacy, the legacy projects in terms of large offshore wind turbine proposals? How do you see? I mean, the obvious question is: could we discover later that a site which was inappropriate for such a development, if it had been designated as a marine protected area, is designated, too late, and the damage is done? How do we address that problem? And would you indeed say that if we were approaching this correctly, that we would have the marine protected areas designated first? And that we would have identified areas where such big industrial development is suitable and where it's not suitable in advance of us issuing consents for development that could potentially be bad for biodiversity or for marine life or for other reasons. Also, could you just... my office staff were watching in on you and they were saying that you made reference to something about 60% of our coastal zone already being designated. Now, she may have misheard you, but could you just clarify that and how coastal zone relates to the new designations of near shore and beyond near shore? And what are we talking about there? And 60% just seems a lot of any area, unless that area is a very... small area. to what extent do you think the precautionary principle, given we are behind the curve, the precautionary principle has to operate in terms of what we allow in advance of the full comprehensive designation of marine protected areas? And pardon again if I'm being ignorant on this, how do areas get how do we sort of select candidate areas, even in advance of their designation? How do we decide on what are candidate areas for protection? And is there a process already, in train for selecting candidate areas?
Deputy Goldberg, Mr. Cronin.
Thank you very much, Chair, and thank you, Deputy. So there's a couple of things there. The first is in relation to the siting of wind farms and marine protected areas. And it was a point I made earlier on, and it's just really to say that it's not necessarily the case that we can't have coexistence. And in my opening remarks, I would have made reference to this. We can, and MPAs do exist in other European countries and around the world, where, and it is best international practice, where you can have human activities coexisting with the conservation objective. So you decide to create an MPA for a specific reason. There's an MPA for a thing in the sea. And then you can have human activity that doesn't have an effect on that conservation status. So the idea of coexistence is very important for us to maybe all think about when we're considering what an MPA is. I would always encourage people to say, finish the sentence. We want an MPA for... and then insert the thing you want it for. That then helps us to understand whether we have a human activity that interferes with that thing or not, okay? So that's one thing. The second thing then is in relation to, are we likely to find something, is there something in these offshore, these legacy projects, is there something in those that may merit protection already? So there's detailed site investigation, takes place, and a lot of science is gathered in the process to create an environmental impact assessment and then do the appropriate assessments. So there's a lot of information, a lot of data is gathered for all of those. And then that then feeds into whether a consent can or cannot take place. So it's not a case of somebody just taking it out and taking out a map and saying, I'd like to put it here, and there you go, off you go. There's a detailed process that exists behind all of that, okay? So that's, I think, just one of the things I'd like to say in relation to that. So then I think another point you raised, Deputy, was, you know, are we doing the cart before the horse here? Or, you know, are we bolting the stable door after the horse is bolted on this issue? Certainly, as I said in some of the other information or evidence I provided, it would be preferable to have started this work a number of years ago, certainly. But we must remember as well that Ireland has a very low level of economic activity in our marine space. So when you go beyond the first nautical mile, apart from transportation and fisheries, there's very little other activity that takes place. So the real risk is quite low outside of those well-defined activities that we have already. Okay. You raised a point then about a reference I made earlier on to different parts of our marine space already having a lot of designated spaces. What I was referring to there was a publication last year by the European Environment Agency where they wanted to highlight the distance to 30%. I can provide a reference to this to the chair of the committee as well. Okay. So it's a publication they provided where it was the distance to 30% MPA coverage across the European Union. And what they did was they broke down each member state's marine space into the first nautical mile, so from the high water mark out to 1 nautical mile, and that was the space I was referring to. And we have those designations done under the Birds and Habitats Directive. And then there was a 1 nautical mile to 12 nautical miles, and they also provided information on how much of that space is designated, and then from 12 nautical miles out to the end of the exclusive economic zone. And that's an area where Ireland is very, very low. That third space there, from 12 miles out, we have very, very low levels of designation there. So that was the specific reference I was making. But I can provide information to the committee on that as well, okay? You, I think, referenced the precautionary principle, which again is one of, I think in my comments, I mentioned the European Union policies and principles, and the precautionary principle is one that we would use all the time. So we would be very conscious of having enough information to make a good decision. That doesn't mean we should make no decision if we don't have enough information. So again, in the exercise of the practice of this, we're very conscious of what is the risk, what's the likely risk of there being some harm caused that is irreversible, for example, or would go against a broader conservation ambition that we have around either a species or around broader biodiversity ambitions. And the last thing I think you raised, Deputy, and if I've missed any of these, you can please come back to me and I'll answer them. I think the last thing you raised was this issue of candidate areas. So again, in one of the other answers I gave, I referenced the fact that we already have a well-established list, and I'll provide the list to the committee as well, a well-established list of threatened and declining species that occur outside the European Union rate directives. So these are what's known as the OSPAR list of threatened and declining species. It's a long list of over 50 species and habitats that occur all across the Northeast Atlantic, and a certain sub-portion of those occur in the Irish marine space. So we know those things that we need to protect. We have information about where they are. So we already have that, we'll say, that information about what are the things we need to go and protect. We also have, and this is included in the Climate Action Plan that was recently published, we have an awareness that the ocean plays a key role in mitigating the effects of climate change. So we believe that there are carbon habitats, natural carbon habitats, both on the coastline and maybe in deeper sediments that are not yet being given any protection. And we believe also that these, and we know where these are, and there's mapping programs for these, we also think that these are things that could become candidates. But what we don't have in place at the moment yet is this, let's call it the process of setting up the criteria, bringing stakeholders along with us, creating the designation process. And this is the role that the new legislation we hope to draft will have. And this is where we see a key role for bringing all the views of the stakeholders who have who will be the people who end up managing this for us, because without their willingness to manage it, it's going to be very difficult for us to do it. It's such a vast area. We need to bring them with us on this. So we feel that legislation and how we design those processes in the legislation will be key to our success.